Good evening, everyone. It's wonderful to see so many of you. It's wonderful to see that on a beautiful summer afternoon, you want to come and hear a talk about Celan, Heidegger, and death. Did have thought of.
We missed the death.
Anyway, I'm delighted to introduce to you, for those of you who don't know him, Dr. Edward Kanterian, who is lecturer in philosophy here at the university. Edward studied in Leipzig and Oxford, and he has an impressively broad range of interests. He's published and edited books in English, German, and Romanian, I think at least. He's translated from languages including Romanian and French, and he's published books, amongst other things, on Wittgenstein and Frege. And his current project, I think, his current main project is on Kant's God.
Yes, correct.
Which sounds intriguing. Perhaps we can hear more about that afterwards. Perhaps most interestingly of all, Edward claims that he sees no meaningful distinction between the analytic and continental traditions of philosophy, which is why we can have a philosopher from an English university department sitting here about to talk to us about Celan and Heidegger. So, I think we're all very anxious and interested to get started. So, Edward's going to talk to us about the darkness of the poem, is the darkness of death, Harald Celan, and the limits of Heidegger's thinking about poetry.
Thank you very much. So my talk will be about Heidegger and Celan. I don't have Martin Heidegger with me, but I do have Paul Celan with me. So before I start, I will allow you to listen to one of his poems at the beginning of my talk. And hopefully, if we have time at the end of it, I will read it out to you again, or make him read it out to you again, and the second time with an English translation. So the first time, just listen a bit to his voice and his mood.
Es war Erde in ihnen. Es war Erde in ihnen und sie gruben. Sie gruben und gruben, so ging ihr Tag dahin, ihre Nacht. Und sie lobten nicht Gott, der, so hörten sie, alles dies wollte. Der, so hörten sie, alles dies wusste. Sie gruben und hörten nichts mehr. Sie wurden nicht weise, erfanden kein Lied, erdachten sich keinerlei Sprache. Sie gruben. Es kam eine Stille, es kam auch ein Sturm, es kamen die Meere, alle. Ich grabe, du gräbst, und es gräbt auch der Wurm. Und das Singende dort sagt, sie graben. O einer, o keiner, o niemand, o du, wohin ging's, das nirgend hinging? O du gräbst, und ich grab mich dir zu, und am Finger erwacht uns.
Paul Celan committed suicide in 1970 in Paris. Among the very few papers found among his possessions in his last flat was found the following draft of a letter. Quote, Heidegger, that you, by your stance, decisively weaken the poetic as such, and I venture to surmise, thinking as such, weaken both with respect to their serious will to responsibility. Unquote. This talk attempts to elucidate what Celan might have meant by these lines. I start with Heidegger. Throughout his work, Martin Heidegger believed that philosophy had to be radically renewed. The evolution of Western metaphysics is a story of decline, due to a major failure started with Plato. The failure to pursue the question of being, the most important metaphysical question. This question may have different versions. Why is there something rather than nothing? What is it to exist, to be? What is the ground of all existing things? In his early work, Heidegger's focus was not on language, but on existence, ontology. In Being and Time, published in 1927, Heidegger had attempted to pose the question of being again through the existential analysis of man himself, what he called Dasein, being there. Why man? Because man has the privileged access to the question of being. He is able to question his own being. To this end, being and time attempted to overcome the abstract conceptions of man found in previous philosophies, with their tendencies to lose touch with the realities of man's actual existence, treating man as an entity or an object among others, no matter what special entity that might be. But man's essence is not Descartes' res cogitans, Hume's bundle of ideas, or Kant's transcendental subject. Against these figments of philosophical imagination, these, as he called them, fantastically idealized entities, Heidegger offered an analysis of real man, especially of limiting situations like feeling anxiety, angst, absurdity, nothingness, and realizing our temporality and mortality. These situations, rare as they are, allow us to pose the question of being, because they make us realize that there is something at all rather than nothing. As he put it in a controversy with Ernst Cassirer in 1929, philosophy's task is to utterly deliver man to anxiety. For, I quote, "Only when I grasp nothingness or anxiety do I have the possibility to understand being. Being is not to be understood if nothingness is not understood." Unquote. But soon after Being and Time, Heidegger became critical of his early approach. Its shortcomings were threefold. First, the existential analysis of Dasein owed more to traditional metaphysics than he had wanted. Being and Time had too much focused on the individual Dasein and its general ontological features. His existential analysis, if correct, would be valid for any human at any time. Dasein was simply a more sophisticated and less rationalistic version of, say, Kant's transcendental subject. But man's rootedness to the soil in life, man's Bodenständigkeit, could not be grasped by the general framework of being and time in the very act of understanding that framework. Second, this contrast between theory and practice, or life, clashed with Heidegger's conception of philosophy. Pursuing the question of being is not a purely theoretical exercise. By questioning our own existence, being itself becomes something worth questioning. But the question of being does not merely merge out of our own existence. It also returns and affects our existence. Heidegger uses the word zurückschlägt into our Dasein. But the abstract framework of being and time can't affect our existence because it does not pay tribute to my individual situatedness. And hence, being and time could not pursue the question of being in all its concreteness and had to be abandoned. Third, Heidegger soon realized that we cannot force the forgotten question of being. Forcing this question is just another manifestation of the metaphysical spirit, of Western hubris and subjectivity, of the will to power. That Plato and his followers missed to properly ask the question of being was not some kind of mistake, which a new approach to ontology may rectify. If Western metaphysics did not pursue the right approach to being, then this was due to being itself. It did not offer itself to be questioned. In Being and Time, being was dependent on Dasein still, on its existential moods and philosophical pursuits. Now, in his later work, being became independent, like a dark and mysterious force active in human history, determining its most general and dramatic features. Forgetting the question of being, Seinsvergessenheit, became an episode in the history of being itself, namely of the concealment and abandonment of being. Hence, Western philosophy, metaphysics, became an episode in the history of being, namely the episode in which being concealed itself since the Greeks. And because being, the ground of all things, concealed itself, the relation of man to the world became impoverished. Through Descartes' thinned-out concept of material objects as res extensa, the mathematized study of nature arose, science. And through science, the world, understood as mathematizable in principle, became the object of manipulation and management, technology. A smoothly running iron cage, but one in which humans become increasingly more disoriented, disillusioned, and uprooted. Forgetting the question of being explains the crisis mankind finds itself in, the darkness of our time, the world night, Weltnacht, as he puts it in an essay. Here is his diagnosis from 1935 in the lecture Introduction to Metaphysics. This is on a quote on the handout. Soviet Russia and America, seen metaphysically, are both the same. The same hopeless frenzy of unchained technology and of the ruthless organization of the average man. The spiritual decline of the earth has progressed so far that the peoples are in danger of losing their last spiritual strength, the strength that makes it possible even to see the decline. The darkening of the world, the flight of gods, the destruction of the earth, the reduction of human beings to a mass, the hatred and mistrust of everything creative and free. Sounds a bit like the REF, I find. Believing that being and time had been only another chapter in this all-encompassing history of being, Heidegger attempted, from the early 1930s onwards, a more radical transformation of philosophy, which he called the turning, Kehre. He paid much greater tribute to the historical situatedness of man in a culture and its communal destiny, in his case, the German people. He looked at the historical phenomena of science and technology to understand, ex negativo, in what ways being had concealed itself through this phenomena. And he attempted to pay tribute to the very situatedness of his own thinking, growing ever more skeptical of traditional philosophical terminology, subject, substance, object, etc. He became more acutely aware of the role of language in philosophy and in the history of being. He went to great lengths to express his thoughts in a language untainted by metaphysics, for what would not retrace the deeper currents in the history of being by reusing a language which had emerged precisely out of that of the blindness to that history. And so he looked for a language which pointed both back to the time prior to the inception of metaphysics and possibly forward to a time in which being will reveal itself. Heidegger found this language in the language of the poets, not just any poet, but the German metaphysical poets, for instance Rilke and George, and especially Friedrich Hölderlin. Heidegger wrote an enormous amount of poetry, and just on Hölderlin, according to my own most recent counting, 1,300 pages, from the very early 30s to the end of his life. Whence the importance attributed to poetry and to Hölderlin in particular? 3 points stand out. First, language is the house of being. In Being and Time, Heidegger had not paid much attention to the situatedness of man in a concrete language. There was nothing ontologically significant about language. Propositional truth was explained as being secondary to truth aletheia, understood as that which is disclosed in man's practical engagement with the world. In early Heidegger, language was at best a tool to get around in the world, at worst an opportunity for chatter. And it was a means to distract from humans' authenticity and mortality. Maybe a bit like Twitter today. But in his attempt to situate philosophy on more originary and real ground, He became convinced that language stands in a most intimate relation to being. Language holds and protects the various possibilities in which we can engage with things in the world. But language also allows for reflection about things as things, and indeed of the world as a whole, of the world as such, of existence as such. In his essay, Why Poets, from 1946, Heidegger concludes, after a long discussion of Rilke, thus, this quote is also on the handout, language is the precinct, templum, the house of being. The essence of language is neither exhausted in reference, nor is it only a matter of signs and ciphers. Since language is the house of being, we therefore arrive at things by constantly going through this house. When we go to the well, when we go through the woods, we already go through the word well, through the word woods, even when we don't utter these words and don't think about language. Consequently, unquote, consequently, if language is the house of being, then attending to language will open us up to reflection about being and possibly help us end our desolate age. Second, in The Origin of the Work of Art, an essay from the mid-1930s, Heidegger claims that language itself is poetry in the essential sense. Poetry is here for him Dichtung, a technical term, which does not simply mean a literary text, whether in prose or verse. Rather, Dichtung means invention, creation. But not mere random invention. Rather, invention in a specific artistic sense. Heidegger's example for such an invention is a painting by Van Gogh displaying a pair of worn-out peasant shoes. You find that on the back side of one of the handouts. Whether it's a peasant shoe, by the way, is not entirely clear. Also, there were several paintings by Van Gogh of such shoes. The painting is not simply a one-to-one representation of some material objects called shoes. A photograph accompanied by a precise scientific description of the physical properties of the shoes would be such a representation, and we would not need art. Rather, the painting discloses the whole world of the peasant, discloses the shoes as they are part of this world. It discloses the arduousness and somberness of the peasant's world. The painting makes manifest what the shoes really are, as shoes, as tools of a human being, by displaying them just in the right way, without their owner, and still making the owner in her and her world so very present. But the painting also makes the opposite of the human world present, earth, which poses so much resistance to man, visible from the state of the shoes. In displaying the conflict between world and earth in a way unseen before, the painting is creative and truthful at the same time. It is creative in displaying the truth of the being of the shoes in such a way that we see the shoes for the first time as what they really are, and in the context of the conflict, the rift between the world and earth and their unity. So the painting is not simply just representing, you know, a piece of matter out there. It's doing much more than that. So this is art's radical novelty and ontological significance. Heidegger writes, "It is due to its creative poetic essence that art, in the midst of things, clears an open place in whose openness everything is other than it was before." Art brings things to shine and sound. And this is what the work of art is in general, the creative poetic bringing into the open of the being of things. Hence, this also holds for poetry understood in the ordinary sense, poesie, if you know some German, so Poesie in German means simply verse or some kind of literary text, traditionally with a rhyme. But poesie, and thus language, have a privileged place. For if things had no names, art would not be possible. In fact, human life and history wouldn't be possible without poesie. Heidegger seems to imply here that even ordinary language is traceable to the creative activity of poets. In addition, language safeguards the possibility of new creative poetic revelation. This makes language poetry in the essential sense. And since language is the house of being, we begin to see what dramatic importance Heidegger attributes to poetry with respect to the question of being. Poetry gives us the timid uncovering of the hidden question of being. And finally, point three, why does he choose Hölderlin? Why is Hölderlin his superstar? For three reasons. Because Hölderlin is a poet's poet, because he is the German poet, and because he is both a commemorative and a prophetic poet. First, Hölderlin is a poet's poet because he addresses, in his poetry, the essence of language and the place of the poet in the world, between earth and heaven, between the mortals and the divine ones. Moreover, for Heidegger, the very essence of poetry, as just explained, speaks and is renewed in Hölderlin's poems through his consistently inventive language, and also through individual lines, such as when Hölderlin writes, "Voll verdient, doch dichterisch wohnet der Mensch auf dieser Erde," full of merit, but poetically dwells man on this earth. So you can see how Hölderlin defines this meaning of human existence as being essentially poetic. Obviously, Heidegger picked up on Hölderlin. Second point, Hölderlin is the German poet because he addresses the historical destiny of the German people. For instance, in the great hymns The Rhine and Germania, to which Heidegger dedicated detailed interpretations. In studying Hölderlin's language, Heidegger found a means to historicize the question of being and place it in a historical cultural context untainted by metaphysics. Hölderlin's focus on Germany was particularly important to Heidegger in the 1930s and is not unrelated to his Nazi episode. But Heidegger's interest in the German language and Hölderlin survived this episode. Third, Hölderlin is commemorative and prophetic because he is backward-looking to the vanished glory of Greece and her gods, and he is forward-looking to a possible future in which the gods, including Christ, will return and men will be reconciled with their destiny again. Heidegger attends to Hölderlin's poetry to obtain hints about the forgotten history of being and maybe hints about the way out of our desolate time. First poetry, then philosophy. For Heidegger, Hölderlin's poetry is the true force of history. Okay, I turn now to Celan. We can see why Paul Celan was so interested in Heidegger. He owned nearly 30 volumes by Heidegger and read many of them very carefully. We have the notes, actually. We have the volumes, actually, with the notes, including those volumes which I have already mentioned. No other thinker had empowered poetry in this way. The sibylline ability of German poetry to uncover and recover something of great value, now lost or in peril, strongly appealed to Celan. Celan wrote in German. Like Hölderlin, Celan was a thinking poet, a poet's poet. Reflecting on the essence of language, poetry, history, being aware of, I quote, "the dark skies under which we live." In a letter to a friend, he wrote this. Had Heidegger not stipulated precisely that, I quote, "out of the desolation of the time, poets must poetically invent the essence of poetry in their very poems," unquote. And how desolate Celan's times were. He was a Holocaust survivor. His parents were enslaved and shot by the Germans in the Ukraine. His mother, after she was not found fit for slave labor any longer. Celan struggled all his life with these losses and found it increasingly difficult to speak about them in the language his mother had taught him at home, which at the same time was the language of the murderers of his mother. His poetry was an attempt to recall the voices of the dead and to display, through these voices, the defining devastation of our age. To bring into the open the character of our time by the right poetic invention. To sketch a chapter in the history of being. To what extent is Celan's poetry an application of Heidegger's philosophy of poetry? To what extent can Heidegger's philosophy of poetry account for Celan's poetry? We choose a few poems to investigate this from the early, middle, and late period. I start with the poem Aspen Tree on the handout. I should maybe read it out, bits of it at least. Aspen Tree, your leaves glance white into the dark. My mother's hair was never white. Dandelion, so green is the Ukraine. My yellow-haired mother did not come home. Rain cloud, above the well do you hover? My quiet mother weeps for everyone. Round star, you wind the golden loop. My mother's heart was ripped by lead. Oaken tree, oaken door, who lifted you off your hinges? My gentle mother cannot return. The poem Aspen Tree was written in post-war Bucharest in 1945. It was published three times in 1948, so it must have been particularly important to Celan. He had not read any Heidegger yet at this stage. The poem has some conventional elements. The loss of the mother, which is expressed to the line-by-line contrast with nature's plenitude and with human suffering. This contrast is also visible in a poem by Hölderlin, namely Half-Life. I think I messed up the handouts and you don't have Hölderlin's poem, but it's not so tragic. So we have similarities here between the contrast of nature and the human world in both Hölderlin and Celan. For Hölderlin, nature is a sign of the gods. Of course, this element of the holy or sacred is missing in Celan. But there is still nature, unharmed and harmonious, at least to some extent harmonious, if we ignore the very first line, leaves glancing into the dark. For both poets, there is something untouched by human history and suffering, although this contrast offers no consolation for the human side. It is curious that Heidegger does not comment Hölderlin's poem as such, although he comments so many others. Heidegger mentions it once in lectures on Hölderlin's Germanic poems, but only in order to point out the phrase sobering holy water. This is because Heidegger waits a turn for the better in human history, and the poetry which states an unbridgeable rift between man and nature can't serve the commemorative and prophetic role he requires to pursue the question of being. But could we not maybe at least say that Celan's poem satisfies at least the commemorative side of poetry Heidegger is so keen on? Put in Heideggerian terms, Celan is a poet in desolate times, not quite because he sings to attend to the track of the fugitive gods, but at least Celan sings to attend to the track of the vanished souls, and thus he brings into the open the rift between earth and human history. Revealing this rift belongs to the ontological significance for art, of art for Heidegger, as we have seen. Hence, this would make Celan a metaphysical poet on Heidegger's terms, although one inferior to Hölderlin, because Celan does not trace the fugitive gods and announce their return. However, there are some problems with this Heideggerian interpretation of aspen tree. First, for Heidegger, the rift between earth and world is a rift between two sides belonging to each other in a unity on a higher plane. It is the intimate belonging together of those struggling with each other. He calls it in German, die Innigkeit des sich zugehörens der Streitenden. But there is no indication in Celan's aspen tree or in his other poetry that there is any such unity on a higher plane, and that his poetry makes appear the truth of this unity. The second problem with Heidegger's Heideggerian interpretation of Celan. For Heidegger, the commemorative side of poetry is internally related to its prophetic side. The poet remembers the flight of the gods for the sake of their possible return. He is constantly on the gods' track, which Heidegger defines as the sacred, the element of the ether for the advent of the gods. Clearly, tracking the gods contains a prospective aspect. So, all the while, the poet remains close to the gods, uttering the sacred. They haven't departed for good or died. We are in the world's night, Weltenacht, true enough, but the poet's prophetic tracking of the gods shows that the world's night is the sacred night. The inextricable link between commemoration and prophecy makes it impossible to recover Celan on Heideggerian grounds. We can't say, well, Celan got half of the story right, namely the commemorative side, if the prophetic side is entirely missing in his poetry. There is nothing to await in Celan's poem, only something to lament, without prospect of reconciliation. This trait will become only more acute in his later work. Third problem with Heidegger's interpretation of aspen tree. The commemorative aspect of this poem, which is indeed pervasive throughout Celan's work, is different from what Heidegger has in mind. Celan is not concerned with recollecting some higher powers or hidden fundamental forces of history being. He is also not concerned with the conflict between nature and the human world as such, but with the contrast between a seemingly peaceful nature and his dead mother, a particular individual. The poem resembles more a memorial or a gravestone for one human being, with no apparent reference to the history of being. Also, Heidegger's explanation of poetry as bringing into the open the being of things to make them shine and sound is entirely inappropriate with respect to Celan's dead mother. As a possible reply on Heidegger's behalf, could we not say that the poem brings into the open the dead mother as a dead being? This would be compatible with the ontological significance of poetry pointed out by Heidegger. Aspen tree discloses the death of humans from one particular angle. And anyway, it is not true that the poem is totally fixated on a particular individual. For in the third stanza, we read, "My quiet mother weeps for everyone." The German is here crucial. Meine leise Mutter weint für alle. The apostrophe after weint indicates the omission of a letter for the past tense, weinte, which means wept, not weeps. Strictly, the line should translate as my quiet mother wept for everyone, which would indicate a particular event in the past. But phonetically, weint also means the present tense, weeps. I have this this interpretation from an excellent book by a German expert on Heidegger and Celan. You know what's awaiting you if you want to specialize in this. In later editions, Celan deleted the apostrophe altogether, as Felstiner, his biographer, tells us. A dead person can't weep for anyone, hence the lime turns the dead person, the dead mother, into a universal symbol of human suffering. So it's not really that Celan's poetry is just about the individual. There is also a universal symbolic element. Fourth, this reply, Heideggerian type of reply, brings Heidegger into difficulty. Celan's mother did not simply suffer and die, but was murdered in historically specific circumstances. Prima facie, this point should aid Heidegger, for he chose poetry as a guide to the question of being, precisely because of poetry's situatedness in history, the history of being. As Heidegger wrote in The Origin of the Work of Art, poetry is the uttering of the disclosure of things. Each language is the happening of that uttering in which a world rises up historically for a people, folk, and the earth is preserved as that which remains closed. In his early Hölderlin lectures from the mid-30s, Heidegger had even expressed the hope that poetry can give rise to a great shaking up of the historical being of people. And he blamed culture and liberalism for obstructing such a shake-up. But of course, we know what that shaking up meant for the German people back then. The rise of the Nazis, initially supported by Heidegger, the Second World War, the Holocaust. This brings us to the German guilt. If poetry and language, German, are cashed out in terms of a world rising up historically for a people, the Germans, what shall we do with the German-speaking Jews? What world was rising up historically for them in 1933? Or was it dawning? What was Hölderlin telling them? Can their catastrophe be made coherent with Heidegger's account of the history of being and of poetry? Can the German catastrophe of having built the gas chambers be subsumed under the history of being? And is Hölderlin still the foremost German poet? I move on to the next poem. Unfortunately, this one is not on the handout. It's called, at least the first of the several I want to mention here, Nearness of Graves. Witness another early poem by Celan, Nearness of Graves. The poem employs the language of classical German poetry with great mastery. We almost hear the romantic melancholy of a poem such as Eichendorff's Die Nachtblume. Which speaks of the soft beating waves in one's heart. In German, schließ dich nun auch Herz und Mund, die so gern den Sternen klagen, leise doch im Herzensgrund bleibt das linde Wellen schlagen. Nonetheless, the way in which the familiar images of waves, windmills, and willows combine in Celan's poem Nearness of the Graves no longer relates to the world of Hölderlin, or even Eichendorff. If the water gives waves which wounded the mother, this is the first stanza of that poem, then what kind of water are we even talking about here? It doesn't seem to belong to this world, water that wounds a human being. The last stanza of the poem overcomes romanticism altogether. It is a reflection of and on the romantic idiom itself, its basic vocabulary, murmuring it like an echo of the past. It is, of course, the past of the Jewish mother who had cultivated the German language at home and from whom this language has now become separated as something to be endured. Endured not so much by the mother, already dead, as by the poet's son who writes in this language, about this language, and against this language. A similar passage occurs in a much later poem, Wolfsbein. You find this on the handout. A poem written by Celan after he had much refined his poetic powers. Hölderlin is explicitly quoted here at the beginning of the poem. Right? Oh, you flowers of Germany, oh, my heart is turning to crystal that cannot lie, in which the light is tested when Germany. But the fact that Hölderlin is quoted here at the beginning of the poem is actually an ironical antithesis to what is to follow. Namely, the most explicit lines in Celan's poetry about the murder of his mother and the German-Jewish destiny. German language itself, the names of the flowers of Germany, in other words, the words of the German language themselves, which his mother had cultivated at home, have turned into substitutes for weapons. Okay, you see this a bit further down in bold. Far away in Mikhailkova, in the Ukraine, where they murdered my father and my mother, what flowered there? What flowers there? What flower, mother, hurt you there with its name? With its name. You, mother, who said wolf's bean, not lupin. It's very important to understand what's going on here. Wolf's bean in German, Wolfsbone, so the German word for this flower. She used the German word for this flower. She didn't use the Latin word for this flower. That's how close she was to German culture. That explains the tragedy that took place. So the German words have now turned into substitutes for weapons. Celan does not present himself as a poet on the same plane as Hölderlin, but in fact as his antipode. So this is contradicting a Heideggerian understanding of Celan. This is also visible in a late poem, Tübingen, January, from 1961, also on the handout, the last page, in which a famous line by Hölderlin is quoted, Ein Rätsel ist rein entsprungenes, auch der Gesang kaum darf es enthüllen. This is from the Rhine from 1801. The mystery of the one born in purity, whom not even song is allowed to reveal too much, appears in Celan as an ironical, syncopated quotation. If a real human came to us today, a prophet, the bearded patriarch, he would not reveal to us some pure and holy mystery, as Heidegger might expect. Rather, he would merely babble and stutter, ever, ever, more, more. You have this at the end of the poem. And as a kind of, quote, erat demonstrandum, Celan quotes Hölderlin again at the very end of the poem, this time from Hölderlin's last period, in which the poet had lost his mind and he was using, once in a while, we are told, the word palaksh. He was using it either in the context in which he wanted to express ascent or descent, but very often when he just wanted to express exhaustion and the inability to say or think anything any longer. Okay, I move on to the last poem. This is also on the handout, With a Changing Key. In September 1953, Celan read Heidegger's Why Poets. He read it very carefully, as his notes show. A month later, his pregnant wife lost their child. Celan wrote a poem with a changing key, commemorating his child. But the snow also points to the death of the parents in the Ukraine. Maybe I should read this, it's short enough. With a changing key, you unlock the house where the snow of what's silenced is driven. Just like the blood that flows from your eye or mouth or ear, so your key changes. Your key changes, the word changes, that may drive with the flakes, just like the wind that rebuffs you, the snow is packed round your world. The motif of snow is frequent in Celan. We find it, for instance, in an early poem that reads, "Now falls mother snow in the Ukraine. Of my tears here none reaches you. What would it be called, mother, growth or wound, if I were to sink into the snowbanks of the Ukraine?" John Felstiner points out that the phrase "changing key" is taken from a fragment by Parmenides about the gates of day and night, of life and death, in which the changing keys are given to the goddess of justice, Dike. Several interpreters of "with a changing key," such as James Lyon and Klaus Manger, suggest that there are direct links or counter-links to Heideggerian themes, especially with Heidegger's claim that language is the house of being. The poem is indeed about this house and what is inside it, because it is about language. But is Heidegger's being inside the house? And does the poet disclose this being, in other words, track the sacred, the gods? No. The picture is rather eerie. The house is full of snow, the snow of what has been silenced, killed. The house is full of nothing alive. It offers no protection. This is in direct contradiction to Heidegger, who writes in his Hölderlin lectures that the poet puts the home-like itself into poetry. Isn't it? Direct contradiction. But there is nothing home-like about Celan's house. Nothing good will come out of it. Language is the changing key. It changes as a function of what causes pain and suffering. Instead of revealing what shines and sounds, as Heidegger put it, language is itself surrounded by snow, endangered. Language, as a key to the house, was supposed to unlock the miraculous content of the house, being. But in fact, the lifeless content of the house, snow, almost a nothing, pursues the key, language, and changes it, modifies it, threatens it. There are two noteworthy themes in this poem from Celan's middle period, which he developed in his later metapoetic reflections, especially in the two speeches he gave in Bremen in 1958 and his Meridian speech from 1960. The one theme is human frailty, creatureliness, Kreaturlichkeit. I know this is a very unusual word in English, but it does exist. Theologians use it. So one of the themes is human frailty, creatureliness, mortality, as indicated by the blood flowing from the eyes, mouth, ear. The second theme is the invention of a poetic language to cope with the frailty and horror, indicated by the changing key, the changing word. Heidegger has difficulties with both themes. Remember Why Poets, his essay, where Heidegger explains that because language is the house of being, this is just going back to the second quote, "When we go to the well, when we go through the woods, we already go through the word well, through the word woods, even when we don't utter these words and don't think about language." A well, the woods. Heidegger's vision here is strangely atemporal, ahistorical, abstract, like an idyllic postcard. It bears little similarity to real history, real humans. What poetry could come out of such a vision, a timeless one? We could have gone to the fountain and to the woods 100 years ago or 2,000 years ago. But the problem is that history is missing here. We don't know what is in the fountain and what happened in the woods. After all, did not the Nazis take Celan's mother to the woods in Krasnopolka in the winter of 1942 to 43? Opposing such lack of concern for real history and the language affected by it and reflecting it, Celan writes in the Bremen speech, this is on the handout, one, a very famous passage by the way, always quoted here when you come across Celan. One thing only remained accessible, close, and unlost amid all the losses, language. Yes, the language remained unlost despite everything, but it now had to pass through its own lack of answers, through being terribly struck dumb, through the thousand eclipses of death-bringing speech. It passed through and gave forth no word for what occurred, but it passed through what occurred, passed through and was finally allowed to crop out again, enriched by all that. The German word is angereichert. In the Meridian speech, Celan brings poetry more explicitly in rapport with human frailty. Indeed, he's the poet's own frailty. He argues that today the poem shows a tendency towards becoming mute. That's also on the handout in the middle. The poem affirms itself at the very edge of itself. It constantly calls itself in order to preserve itself from its never more to be, schon nicht mehr, back into its still here, immer noch. It's very unstable. Its position is very unstable. This still here must still be a speaking, of course. Hence, not language in the abstract, that's against Heidegger, but actualized language. This still here of the poem may only be found in the poem of somebody who does not forget that he too speaks under the angle of inclination of his existence, Neigungswinkel seines Daseins, the angle of his creatureliness. This correlation between human frailty and poem's frailty is expanded upon in Celan's notes for the Meridian speech. He writes, this is also on the handout, the darkness of the poem is the darkness of death. The humans are the mortal ones. Therefore, the poem belongs to the most human in humans as that which commemorates death. Hence, the poem is, judged by its essence and not only by its themes, a school of true humanity. It teaches understanding the other as the other, in its otherness, and invites to brotherliness, to awe for this other, even there where the other, as hook-nosed and deformed, is put on trial by the straight-nosed ones. It is difficult to see how all this could fit with Heidegger's account of poetry. For Celan, the true devastation of our time is the destruction of individual human beings, of other human beings, in Auschwitz and Hiroshima, or Hiroshima. He wrote a poem, by the way, combining those two catastrophes, called Tenebre. The poem is called Tenebre from 1957. Heidegger's devastation is more opaque and unfathomable. His history of being is hard to relate to real human history, despite his anti-metaphysical rejection of abstraction. On the rarest of occasions, in one of Heidegger's country path conversations, written apparently on the day of Germany's capitulation to the Allies in May 1945, Heidegger reflected on the devastation caused by the Second World War. He admitted to a blinded, deplorable leading astray of his people, the Germans. But he had only words for the devastation of the native soil and his inhabitants, so his native soil and its inhabitants. He didn't mention the devastation of other native soils. And even the destruction of Germany is eventually played down by Heidegger because it is not the true devastation, das eigentlich Verwüsten. The devastation in German connects to desert. Even in 1945, then, the true devastation for Heidegger is the abandonment and forgetfulness of being. Auschwitz and Hiroshima were just further chapters in the history of this abandonment, started with the Greeks. As he argued in 1949, quote, this is on the handout as a longer quote, the penultimate one, agriculture is now a motorized food industry, in essence the same as the manufacturing of corpses in the gas chambers. As he explained in his essay Why Poets, what is truly devastating and deadly in our world is not so much, it's not, again, that's the last quote, the much discussed atom or nuclear bomb. Rather, it is the metaphysical will to power that has long threatened man with destruction. Heidegger writes, what threatens man in his essence is the willful opinion that through the peaceful release, transformation, stockpiling, and delivery of natural energies, man could make man's being bearable for all and happy in general. This won't do. The apocalyptic vision presented here, no matter how much it would have appealed to a German audience in 1946 or 49, is only sustained by Heidegger's metaphorical use of the notion, the death of the essence of man. Compared to the real destruction of around 200 Japanese civilians in 1945 and the possible destruction of hundreds of millions of humans in a full-scale nuclear war, this metaphor is hopeless. It does not manage to establish a credible tension between the visible devastation and the invisible true devastation, or a sense of death, as if, faced with these horrible events, there may be still something worth of our attention underlying the real destruction of humans in Auschwitz and Hiroshima. Something which might compel us to turn away from real history and its victims and instead of that focus on the question of being. I'm coming to the end. Heidegger's insensitiveness towards real suffering and real evil, due to his commitment to the hidden history of being as the true happening of human history, is deeply problematic. It brings his conception of being into disrepute, and so his philosophy. This is what Celan meant in his last note on Heidegger's weakening the poetic and thus also thinking. Celan's poetry seems to offer an antidote to such weakening. We have here a German poet's poet writing about the historical destiny of his people, the Jews, and his nation, the Germans, turning German language and poetry against themselves and thus reinventing poetry. While this poetry does speak about our desolate times, the desolation is not the one identified by Heidegger, forgetfulness and abandonment of being. And Celan's poetic work is not a remedy against this desolation, as poetry does not track the sacred and its possible return. Celan's poetry only tracks humanity as much as there is left of it.
Thank you very much indeed. I think for once the cliche about a rich and stimulating paper is true. Could I open the floor to questions, please?
And now you can close it again.
Well, perhaps I can get the ball rolling on the question of mine. Could you just explain briefly why it is that Heidegger seems to like to use negatives, negations, privatives, Aletheia, Weltentschließung, disclosure, uncovering, to define to his way of getting at what he sees as truth, as opposed to propositional truth?
Yes, this is from Being and Time. So the German word is Unverborgenheit. He uses this because presumably already in Being and Time, he wants to contrast truth as traditionally understood, and for him traditionally understood it means correspondence correspondence of a judgment with the facts, so correspondence of the mind with reality in Aquinas. So he wants to get away from that. He doesn't say that propositional truth doesn't exist or is wrong or something, but he wants to say there is this much more fundamental phenomenon of truth upon which propositional truth is based. And the way to think of that is that man is thrown into the world and then he has to rip himself bits from the world to make it his home, right? Mm-hmm. And that's a negation. So it's Unverbundenheit, it is disclosure of reality out there.
It's almost a sort of double negative, actually, isn't it? Mm. Sense to use one concept that is implying a sort of negation of negative, and then using a prefix whether or
not. You're right. Because letter means hiddenness.
Exactly.
So right.
It's a kind of double negative.
It's a river as well. So and it also means forgetting, isn't it?
Yep.
Letter.
Yep.
And so aletheia means then unforgetting.
Yep.
It's partly also because he's a very dark and gloomy man, and he thinks that the essence of humanity is not something that can be eventually rationally understood. So at the ground of our existence, there's this essential darkness. Yeah, and that's why to do truth is to be active. You have to actually do something in order to uncover it.
That's the crucial point. Mm. Shane.
Coming to my proper question in a second, but just as a preliminary, I mean, one of the things you brought out was, maybe you're saying this, is that Heidegger, if you like, one of the massive failings of his thinking is, as you pointed out, his idea of forgetting of being, you know, Zeitgeistvergessenheit is that the beginning and the end of the Western culture. It happens so early. If it happens with Plato, right, so we only have Socratics, we only really have Heraclitus back there and Sophocles. And I think you really brought this up very well. He's totally unable, although he puts all this emphasis on the history of being in his late thinking, he's totally unable to grasp the radicality of what happens when the Nazis come to power. It just forms one more chapter in this history of the forgetting of being.
Mm.
And one of the massive differences between Celan and Heidegger there is that for Celan it is, as it is for the philosophers who come up who are of Celan's generation, and I'm thinking here of Derrida, Philippe Lacoulabart and others, they recognize that, and Adorno too, they place the emphasis on the Shoah being this caesura, this interruption in the Western history. And Heidegger doesn't even begin to think of that event in those terms, doesn't it? It's just another chapter. And the example you give, that famous example from the Loyola speech where he compares the Holocaust, where he compares factory farming to the Holocaust, really demonstrates that.
Yes. Yes, I mean, that passage is of course very problematic, and Lacoulabart and Lyotard, many others have pointed this out, of course. But there is something interesting about that passage because, I mean, part of the feature of the gas chambers were that there were, this was industrialized, managed killing, mass killing. So, I mean, there is something interesting about the passage. Of course, the problem Heidegger has, is that he's not able to recover this particular crime as a crime. He doesn't have the right kind of notions, doesn't have the moral or ethical framework for that, because it's all just a chapter in the history of being in
dream. But it really is just one more chapter, isn't it?
Yes.
So can I then focus it, given that, you sort of accept that, on my question, which is, you were suggesting that Celan is kind of writing back at Heidegger, in a sense, in his poetry, after he starts reading Heidegger in the 1950s, he's really writing. His poetry is, in some sense, a writing back against Heidegger. But there is, and that comes to a head, I suppose, with the poem you didn't talk about, Todnauger, which is when he visits Heidegger, and in a sense, you've got the word death in the title of the very home, Heidegger's very home, you know, it's got, uh, it's got death written into
and
this.
And Organisation Tod.
Yeah.
And Nazi.
Yeah, so I mean, they all come together in that very late poem, which is the last word. But what really strikes me, despite what you're saying, is how much they share. Mm-hmm. They both share this unremitting faith, and Celan, it is in the German language, he says it there. I mean, yeah, he reinvents the German language, but an absolute faith in the power of the German language, an absolute faith in poetry, in a sort of world historical sense, mm-hmm. an absolute faith in Heidegger, both of them. And even more surprisingly, I mean, Celan's abiding engagement with Heidegger, when Heidegger is, in a sense, the worst thing for him, psychologically, you know. I mean, really, he's drawn to what, in some sense, will kill him, isn't he? But they share so much.
Yes. I didn't focus on too much on their common points. I mentioned only briefly.
But would you agree that they're profound?
They are very profound, but they are very hard to work out exactly. Because we can't just say Celan, we can say Celan and Heidegger both think poetry is very important, right? That's not precise enough, right? Because for Heidegger, poetry is important as revealing history of being, etc. But that's not what it is for Celan, right? I mean, otherwise we couldn't say Heidegger also has a lot in common with many other poets, all poets who think poetry is important, right? That wouldn't be enough of a common ground. So we need to look in more detail at their possible shared ground. Yeah.
Don't they share?
So we could maybe work it out.
Be more precise. Don't they share something very profound? For Heidegger, what poetry, what Heidegger can do, and what real poets can do, is to disclose being. That's what it's all about. The poetic word discloses being. Mm-hmm. And that will result in an absolute radical transformation in this history of being and science. Doesn't Celan, in a sense, argue the same thing in the Meridian speech and afterwards, where he conceives as poetry, you picked up on it here, with a changing key, the whole idea of Wende, art and Wende, the whole idea of a turn or a change, don't they share that idea that poetry can affect that kind of...
Yes, I think you have a point. I'm just looking for that particular passage. I mean, it is an art and Wende, but it's much more modest, isn't it? It's not of world historical importance. I think Celan thinks that. I mean, Heidegger thinks that Hölderlin really was the driving force of the hidden driving force of history, recent history at least, of German history. I mean, think about this claim.
What was the book on Celan's death when he went to commit suicide?
It was Heidegger, yes, that's true.
I mean, I think for Celan, the model, especially in these speeches, in the Kremann speech, is more specifically dialogic. It's one of dialogue, isn't it? Mm-hmm. It's one of Gespräch, encounter, conversation.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
In a way, it's less of a primary concern for Heidegger.
Yes, it's not at all a concern for Heidegger, it seems. You see, for Heidegger, poetry is like an oracle, so and Hölderlin is like... you know, somebody employed in an oracle, a priest. And so it's all about listening to this radically other theme that is not human. But
could I ask,
yes.
How seriously do you take Heidegger as a philosopher? Isn't he really a theologian in disguise? How seriously do you take him as a philosopher? I know we're getting a bit away from the poetry theme, but how seriously do you take him as a philosopher?
Well, he seems to me to be a very important philosopher. I mean, certainly with the early Heidegger, it's very hard to dispute it because he is deeply entrenched in traditional philosophy. He's the foremost pupil of Husserl. He knows phenomenology by heart. He knows Aristotle very well.
This is the history of philosophy.
No, but I'm just talking about information now. I mean, how do I take somebody seriously?
Oh, yes, I'm not saying we shouldn't take Heidegger seriously.
Yeah.
It's as a philosopher.
Yes,
I mean,
sure.
Isn't he a theologian? I mean, all this business about being and so on, all this business that you mentioned about the interest in the oracle,
yes.
These are things that priests engage in.
Yes, there is an element of that, but I wouldn't reduce it to it.
She's immensely important as a
critic of the whole sort of Cartesian, Kantian tradition, I think. I mean, as a philosopher, I would say, as a sort of, in the sort of central area of epistemology and metaphysics, Heidegger is enormously important. I mean, I share doubts about the sort of area of his philosophy that you were talking about, and I thought you gave an absolutely devastating critique of it, I must say. I really admire your courage for doing that, and I think, I almost had the sort of Emperor's New Clothes sort of experience, and I wish I had the courage to. The minute you said all those things, I thought, yes, you're absolutely right about the way he sees the Holocaust, the way he sees the atom bomb. I mean, he just sort of flattens it out into this general history of the forgetting of being. And as Shane said, and I think this is right, I mean, it's all, it sort of becomes sort of ahistorical because it's all sort of dated back to the pre-Socratics and it's, it really needs the sort of criticism, I think, that you were making. But, I mean, it does raise the question, and perhaps it's another way of putting the question that Edward was asking. I mean, why is it then that this aspect of Heidegger's philosophy, if you like, is so enormously influential? I mean, I find that quite puzzling. I wonder if you have any thoughts about that.
Well, what can I say? I mean, I'm quite obsessed with Heidegger myself. like Celan, it's hard to get away from. If you know German, right, and you care about poetry, and you think that maybe there is something in philosophy which should relate to poetry too, it's very hard to skip him and just to reject him. I mean, he does address these problems. I mean, he might have gotten things very wrong, but it doesn't mean he's not giving us some first seeds for further thought. And Celan seems to be building up on it. I mean, an interesting thought experiment would be, where would be Celan without Heidegger, right? You would be a real
Kimitate. Yeah,
yes, a real Kimitate.
I mean, I think one of the answers to your question of why Heidegger has been so influential in this aspect in discussions of lyric poetry is simply that he valorizes, rightly or wrongly, in whatever terms, he valorizes lyric poetry so much.
Yeah, so I think that's true.
Which then makes people want to use him to discuss that because it valorizes the discipline, the thing they're working on, the thing they're discussing.
Yes. I mean, is anybody aware of other philosophers who consider the significance of poetry as highly as...
Well, I mean, Heidegger seems to very much be part of the tradition of thinkers who think that literature and poetry in particular has the power to civilize us. And I was thinking of Martin Nussbaum's, cultivating humanity, and there's a long list of thinkers who subscribe to, the statements he makes in the quotation. That's Celan, that one. All right. Oh, sorry, I got confused there. I was looking at the Celan quotation, where he talks about the poem and how it can be a school of true humanity and can teach us understanding the other as the other. So I thought that was a Heidegger.
It's still true, is it?
He probably would.
It's still true. I mean, the answer to that question surely is Heidegger does very much belong to a particular continental tradition, which would also include Adorno simultaneously, Nietzsche before him, perhaps arguably Schopenhauer as well, where there is this privilege accorded to...
It's not just poetry,
it's also Van Gogh, as you showed, to the aesthetic. And that is an ongoing tradition that manifests that really flourishes as well in post-war France. Derrida, Derrida, Deleuze, and others. And it's only when Alain Badiou comes along and says, "Hey, we've got to break with that philosophical tradition that accords this privilege to the aesthetic," that one really gets some distance from it. I don't think Heidegger is unique. Far from it. I think he's very much part of the tradition there, although he devotes perhaps more space and time than any others.
And maybe more significance of poetry, no? And I don't know. It's
I think to the history of Adorno surely sees the aesthetic as it's important as Heidegger does.
This would be something to think about. Yeah.
Do other
people have questions before we talk too much.
Yeah, I was just wondering, is this part of the sort of economy, like making people into sort of economic products rather than human beings, like consumer society, kind of the rise of that sort of thinking of people, like sort of the will to power, like the will to get more money stuff?
Well, this would be... this would be maybe a consequence of the will to power, but it wouldn't be it's not a direct consequence of it. He would say the same he said about Hiroshima. He said, yes, it's terrible that the Wall Street is wrecking the world. I don't know whether it's true or not, but let's assume. But that's not the true terrible bit about this world. That's not the real devastation of this world. Something much deeper underlying all this, and it goes back to the Greeks. So, I mean, you wouldn't have thought, surely, probably, before you read Heidegger, that today's technology and the problems we encounter as a species today go back to the Greeks, go back to Plato, poor Plato.
I mean, you can't take that seriously. I mean, you just can't take that any seriously, it seems to me. I mean, it's fascinating. Nobody else has thrown it out, but I mean, seriously, is Plato responsible for mechanized agriculture? You know, you concretize it.
Well, not directly, but well, coming up with a concept of objects which abstracts from how we relate to them in a real concrete form. So substance would be such a concept, philosophical concept. Of a substance, what is that? It's the underlying of properties, right? For instance.
The metaphysical chain is too skilled.
It springs to other voices, right?
You
characterize what Heidegger regards as a fundamental question as the problem of being. And it's one of those philosophical problems that it's like clouds when you try and grasp them, they vanish in your fingers. But you did, in fairness, try to give some alternative formulations that are more tangible. For example, the question of why there's something rather than nothing, arguably that fizzles out when you inquire into it. But you still didn't make clear how poetry and the examination of poetry touches on that question. I mean, take it in that sharper form, why is there something rather than nothing?
Yes.
What is the study of poetry? How would the study of poetry respond to that question?
Well, it's not a study of any kind of poetry. I mean, in fact, it's the study of art that would respond to this question, and poetry is part of it. It would be by understanding, say, looking at Van Gogh's painting, understanding there is much more to these material items in front of us than we might think if we are just scientists or philosophers who think that these are substances underlying properties. And what are the properties X, Y, and Z? So anything that could be captured, say, by the predicate calculus, or formalized by the predicate calculus, would not be enough to capture the entire the entire being of these shoes. What they really are, what they stand for, what's their relation to their possessor, and so on and so forth. So being is here like a horizon for Heidegger, if that makes any sense.
But isn't that very akin to crude theology in the way that Heidegger was saying? We look at certain phenomena like the fact that no one can understand the beginning of the world, how the world could possibly come into existence, or phenomena like emotion, which seem to defy scientific explanation, and we say, oh, that's a deep mystery, maybe God is the answer, but of course it's no answer, it's just a label. So how does Heidegger's thinking go beyond that very crude reaction?
But it's not so crude. I mean, he did spend thousands of pages investigating it. At the beginning of Being and Time, he starts with Aristotle's concept of being. being as ousia, so, and relates it to the concept of substance. So it's not that he doesn't start out of nowhere with some vague or fuzzy notion of being. He's actually starting with the tradition, received tradition, that was handed down to him. And so concepts such as being and property, existence, etc., were all concepts that were investigated by his predecessors. So it's not that vague. I'm not sure. Why do you think that it's all so vague? Maybe my talk was vague.
Before we get too deep into this, then my
sorry.
There's an interview that the reader gives in Gua, and he speaks about the relationship of philosophy and poetry. And I don't know much about, but what he says the way to see this relation between poetry and philosophy would be through the concept of trauma. And he speaks about psychoanalysis, he speaks about Freud's notion of trauma, and I think that might be his idea of a return of the wound and the idea of binding the wound as well. I don't know whether that would...
Maybe, yes. It's interesting, it's something to think about. But I don't know what to
and
say because I don't know this much.
Since Derrida, his writing is both from Heidegger.
Yes, I've tried to read Derrida's Schiebole essay and failed bitterly, so I stopped. I don't want to read it again. I don't feel like there. Okay, I don't want to sound that good.
The crude answer to that is that trauma model's often been applied to Celan and his what he's doing in writing responding to the.
Yes. Yes. I mean, it could be. There's here a really important question here. Are we not? I mean, all literature on Celan is pro Celan. Yeah. So that doesn't smell right to me. I haven't tried to be the devil's advocate, but that could be also something worth investigating. Maybe we are going a bit too far in assuming that Celan can really pose such a challenge, to a great metaphysician, say, or that in fact his type of poetry could help us understand everything that we need to understand as philosophers in the contemporary world, technology and science in particular. He doesn't spend much time on that at all, on science. Yeah.
Well, do you know lots of Celan scholars? I'd be careful criticizing Celan. They're a very, very prickly bunch.
Well, be fine.
Question over in the corner here.
Just coming back to Lawrence's question about how and why Heidegger thinks that poetry is helpful in inquiring into the nature of being and the question of being. As it kind of seems quite obvious if you try and read Heidegger and the discussion we've been having, kind of the question of being is a difficult thing to talk about in German and English and Greek and any language. So Heidegger perhaps looks at poetry as the sort of language where the question of being can be properly explored, where it's not constrained by the sort of day-to-day uses which it's got. He's kind of got these ideas of... he does a lot of etymological studies where he takes them back to the original Greek word, because that's what the words had their meanings before they were translated, and they kind of lose their meaning because our experience is different to the experience of the Greeks who had them. So I was just wondering kind of in terms of how poetry can look at the question of being.
Well, I tried to explain it, but obviously I didn't do a good job. Heidegger is concerned with language even in being in time. I was maybe a bit unfair in my talk. Well, phenomenologically speaking, he doesn't think language is important for his analysis of Dasein, of existential analysis of Dasein. But for him as a philosopher, language is very important already in being and time, because as all of you know who have opened up being and time and tried to read it, and then failed immediately, that's not normal language that he uses there. He says at the very beginning, introduction, I want to get away from traditional philosophical terminology and coin less misleading terms for the topics I want to investigate. So Dasein is the very best example for that. Being there, Dasein, being there. So his conception, he doesn't operate with the concept of a person. So usually when you do introduction to philosophy, epistemology, or metaphysics, you'll have a chapter on on the personal identity, but he doesn't care about the person at all. It hardly occurs in Being and Time. Why does it not occur in Being and Time? Because he thinks that this concept is too much answery to the traditional concept, again, of a substance. And that would mean that we would be flattening human beings by putting them, you know, in the same line as other things we conceptualize as substances, as being underlyings for properties. He wants to totally get away from it. He thinks that the concept of a substance, such as in a person, does not at all capture what we really are. And so he comes up with this radically different notion.
Two final questions, I think. One here and then...
I have two questions. Just come out the way I looked at YouTube, and there's Heidegger, atheist, and he uses the expression, perhaps in answer to the question about what use of poetry be, or what use is Heidegger's approach, and he uses, and I want you to explain this to me, he says, das Bedeutsame ist das Primäre.
Sorry, that's...
Das Bedeutsame ist das Primäre.
Where does he say that?
He says it in a lecture on YouTube. an aged lecture. It's about 84. I don't know what the future of philosophy is going to be. And then he says, great emphasis.
Yes, I mean, this is perfectly compatible with his phenomenological approach in Being and Time, because he wants, again, he doesn't want to say, okay, look, Descartes conceptualized objects as being just items of res extensa. They're all the same in this respect, that they are res extensa. But how did Descartes himself, sitting in his comfortable chair, even come up to this concept? I mean, it's not that it dropped upon him, right? Where did he bring it from? What's the condition for the possibility of coming up with such an abstract concept of an object, of a substance? And he says, well, before Descartes can even start doing his philosophy, he has to sit down, pour himself some tea in his cup. What's the relation he has with the cup? That's the question. Is it a relation between a res cogitans and a res extensa, or is it some other kind of relation between the two of them? And he wants to say there's some other kind of relation going on, and I want, through my phenomenological analysis, uncover this specific relation that we entertain with the objects around us which are significant to us, bedeutsam to us. So in that sense, bedeutsamkeit or significance is primary for him. Primary in the sense of it's the way in which we normally encounter objects around us without even realizing.
Do you still have time for the poem in English?
We have one more question.
No, it's all right. I sort of figured out in my head as I was thinking.
Okay. If you would like to have the poem in English, I think it's a request.
Well, here is... No, it's still in German because I want him to read it out to us, but I want you to follow it line by line in English. It's not very fast. It's going to be easy to follow.
Okay.
Well, whoever knows German doesn't need it, of course.
Well, not sure we can anymore.
God, yes, maybe. Wait, just try that. I can maybe raise it, actually. Must find it first. Here, what I want to do is open it with a different program, which is much louder. VLC called. Wait a second.
Just play on the other one and turn around so everyone can hear.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Oh, wait, it's starting now. Should be.
Es war Erde in ihnen. Es war Erde in ihnen und sie gruben. Sie gruben und gruben, so ging ihr Tag dahin, ihre Nacht. Und sie lobten nicht Gott, der, so hörten sie, alles dies wollte, der, so hörten sie, alles dies wusste. Sie gruben und hörten nichts mehr, sie wurden nicht weise, erfanden kein Lied, erdachten sich keinerlei Sprache, sie gruben. Es kam eine Stille, es kam auch ein Sturm, es kamen die Meere, alle. Ich grabe, du gräbst, und es gräbt auch der Wurm, und das Singende dort sagt, sie graben. O einer, o keiner, o niemand, o du. Wohin ging's, das nirgend hinging? O du gräbst, und ich grab mich dir zu, und am Finger erwacht uns der Ring.
Perhaps it's appropriate to end with Celan's voice, and it just remains to invite any of those who would like to come for a drink to the Wabenkin to continue the conversation, otherwise to thank Edward for a very interesting talk.